interesting room. I'm going to have to walk back and forth so I can cover all of you. It's a great pleasure to be here. So I currently live in Switzerland, a neutral country. I was born in Germany, so if I speak about perfection, I know what I'm talking about. But I also lived in San Francisco and Boston in the US for 17 years, so if I speak about awesomeness, that's my American part. I can fuse all of those together. I was just thinking as the introduction was happening is that we're really moving in a world that used to be dumb in the sense of disconnected, well, basically not networked, to a world that's becoming smart. That's now. And then after we get smart, what is the next step? Human. Because this is the interesting part, what's happening with automation and robotics is that it's going to force us to figure out what it means to be human. Because if we actually are, in the end, reducing the workforce by, some people say, 50%, that sounds like it's going to be great for the margin and the efficiency, right, and the profit, but it changes the entire makeup of society. And then in addition to this, of course, all of us will live to be older. Our kids are very likely to live to be 90 or 100 as a default, right? I mean, we're gaining currently 8 hours a day of longevity. That's 1/3 of a year in 1 year. Mind-boggling, right? And the whole possibilities of, for example, genetic engineering. The cover of Wired magazine last week. The possibility of defeating cancer. Changing the genes to not have Alzheimer's. Imagine what that will do to global population, of course. So lots and lots of issues for business and for society. I will touch on those today. We're going to distribute the PDF later on through the app, I think. And we'll also take questions, of course, through the app and actually in person as well. We can take questions in person. That's still possible also. I have quite a few slides, so we're also going to do some polling to get your opinion on things. I currently focus my work as a futurist on these very simple things here. Most people think that a futurist is somebody who can predict the future or is trying to, or of course that would be ludicrous to do that. I think there are some people who could do that, like Alvin Toffler and really brilliant people, Ian C. Clarke and so on, and maybe Ray Kurzweil. My work is on foresights. And foresights is what we all have if we had time to listen to them. There's a great saying in China, every time I speak in China, people are saying, well, basically, if you want to know about the future, ask your children. Well, it's obvious, you know, kids don't have to make money. They're not busy trying to figure out how to earn a living, right? So they can play, they can experiment, and this is why they know the future. So my work's about foresights, it's about observations. And before I get going, I would like to encourage you also to spend 3 to 5% of your time on foresights, which is to look at what's happening, observe, and work about 5 years into the future. If you do that, your job will be safe. And this is one of the key issues for companies, is not looking at what could be, but looking at what is. And of course, you know, you have to look at what is, because that's how you make a living, right? But 3 to 5%, Google does about 10%. The engineers are allowed to do 20%, allegedly. I don't really know how that actually works anymore. But this is a very, very important thing for our future. My company is based in Switzerland and also in San Francisco, and our motto is, it wasn't raining when Noah built the ark. And that is so true for many of our customers or clients. We have over 200 clients going from Samsung to Sony to newspaper organizations and consumer brands and consulting companies, many others. And so basically the idea of saying, let's take a look at what's happening by 2020 so we can develop a plan how we can be part of that future. I'll give an example. 6 years ago we did a brainstorming workshop for the CEOs of a really big German automobile brand, a car brand. And all the CEOs of the different divisions were there. 6 years ago we said, okay, basically it's quite clear, self-driving autonomous cars, electric cars, shared cars, public cars, you know, that sort of thing that we have today. And what we got was laughter, just flat-out laughter. Well, guys like us, you know, we like fancy cars, right? So we buy fancy cars. You can't possibly imagine that somebody would want to share a Tesla self-driving car through an app or something, you know, which is basically is the topic number one today. Every single car company in the world is looking for electric vehicles, for patents, for ideas for public cars, and so on. Right? That's a huge shift. And if you're the CEO of Porsche, right, would you appreciate this kind of shift? Not really. Right? I mean, it's a lot better to sell $200,000 vehicles to a bunch of people who have the money than to sell a $20,000 Porsche self-driving car to the city of Singapore, right? That's obviously better. I mean, I used to be a musician and producer. In those days, we sold records. Right? Remember that record? You know, okay, plastic. Today, if you give a CD or a DVD to your kids for Christmas, they call a therapist. Right? It's like, doesn't even exist. So in those days, it was $20 for a CD that you would sell it for, and you would get maybe three or four from the sale. Right? Today, you're on Spotify, you get 0.0000001 cent per play. Right? So that's how society has changed. This is the most important curve, right? Exponential development. And this is very hard to understand because, you know, humans are not exponential. We don't live faster because we use Twitter. We don't have more friends, really, because we have Facebook or LinkedIn. We can't. We're limited to 150 people in our closest surrounding. We're not going to have 15,000. Even Deepak Chopra wouldn't have 150,000 people as friends, right? I mean, it's impossible. So this curve is really tough for us because also the other thing is when we're at the beginning of the curve here, we're basically at 0.001, and then we double that, it's still nothing. But if you count from 1 to 7 on the linear curve, you get to 7. When you count exponential, you get to 100. Now think about that difference. What that means is that every year, Moore's law, Metcalfe's law, and so on, this is a mind-boggling challenge for us to imagine what the world would look like in 5 years from today. It's going to be like going into a science fiction novel, like literally. I was in Tokyo 3 months ago using an app called Say Hi. And Say Hi allows instant translation in real time through the app in 34 languages. I had a half-hour conversation with a sushi chef in Japanese. I mean, about simple stuff, of course, not about, you know, personal problems or something. But it worked fine. I spoke into the app in German, came out in Japanese, and he did it the other way around. And that's like Star Trek, right? And now every day we're facing those issues that are happening. We're basically at the pivot point of technological change, exponential change. So if you think the world is a crazy place today, just give it 5 years, you won't even recognize. There'll be things that you think that clearly are not possible. Take intelligent digital assistants. Siri, Cortana, you know, all that stuff that we already have. It's not that impressive. You know, it works, but think about that exponentially. It will outsource everything that your personal assistant, your person, you know, flesh and blood person does today. It will do all of that in 5 years, and more, and better, and cheaper, or for free. In fact, Google will give it to you for free in return for your data. Right? Of course, that's their business model, right? The Faustian bargain. Humanity will change more in the next 20 years than the previous 300 years. A lot of people are saying, well, you know, that's not... We had big changes in the printing press and the industrial society and the steam engine. Yes, that's all true. But what's happening today is exponentially so much bigger. Now, if you're running a business, you have to be aware of that, of course, and of course personally as well, because you're going to have to prove your own value. And how do you prove your own value in an exponential world? Well, not by beating machines, right? There's just no way we can do that. We're not going to be faster, quicker, smarter, more efficient than the machines, right? For a while, it looked like we could, right? But Ray Kurzweil, the founder of the singularity movement, there's many issues I have with that, but I'll quote him anyway. He says in 2027, we're going to be at the point where the capacity of one computer will be equal to the human brain. Will probably happen before that. Right now, the capacity of the most advanced computer is a cricket in terms of the brain activity. So exponential change coming in this direction. And you can clearly say this is my keyword number one, hell then. Right? I use the hashtag on Twitter, hell then, which is hell and heaven combined. Because right? It could be both. Right? Our job in business is to make sure this is mostly heaven. And that's our job. There's no way we can avoid the unintended consequences. For example, the more data that we have available, the more naked we get, so to speak. Right? People can find us a lot more stuff about us. So if you're on LinkedIn to do networking, you become more naked, and that's kind of a side effect, right? But you don't want that side effect to overweigh the positive result. So that's why I call that hell then. It's very important to keep that in mind. And we're still vastly underestimating the velocity of that change, too. Right? Looking at this graph, autonomous vehicles, it says here that in 2035, we'll have roughly 100 million models sold. That was only 3 months ago. You know what the expectation is now? 1.5 billion. Right? This is just, the velocity is mind-boggling. Now we have 3D printed cars. Right? This company called Local Motors, 50 parts. It will print the car with a 3D printer. How real that is? You know, I know the General Electric is looking to print parts of the engine and eventually print the entire airplane engine with a 3D printer. Think about what that would do for manufacturing or shipping, logistics. I do a lot of work for Unilever on their ideas of the future. And some of those companies are now looking into printing ice cream on demand in a 3D printer. Right? So you don't ship the ice cream, you ship the printer. Right? I mean, these things are going to be velocity, really amazing. So it's no longer the question about what if. You know, this was the question when I grew up doing startups on the internet. Right? Said, what if we could put the music into the cloud and then people would download it, you know, and pay a little bit for that? That was 1997, before Napster. The question today is this, right? What, when, not what if. Because when you look at technology and you ask a question, can technology actually do this, right? The answer is always yes. Well, like 98% of the time. Because it's possible now. The question is, can we invent solar energy and distribute it around the globe so it can solve our energy problem? The answer is yes, but you know, when, how much investment will it take? But it's basically yes. 2015 will be the first year where a major oil company will leave the oil business to go into renewables. Well, the oil price isn't coming back, and I'm sure you know, you're aware of that, right? I mean, it's not going to go up again. So you're losing money sticking with an old business, you know. Talk about painful change. Huh? I mean, looking at this number here, we are here at the takeoff point where human performance is slightly better than machine performance today. But that point is over soon. And that is probably a good thing. And I would grant you, in your organizations, you can probably save tons of money and make a better margin and automate. That's a good thing. But I'll tell you about what that means, really, in the long run. It seems like a good thing, and it is, but it's not permanent, right? I mean, the purpose of life isn't efficiency, right? Efficiency is a good piece of that equation. I mean, if you look at what's happened with genetic engineering, sequencing the genome, 10 years ago, $1 million, today, $734. In 5 years, it'll be cheaper than flushing the toilet. Okay? And basically, in 5 years, we will all be able to have our genome sequenced. It'll be standard procedure. Imagine what happens then. Okay? Talk about machine learning. We could put all that stuff into a giant engine. That's a pretty mind-boggling. You know, then we get into ethical things. You know, should we allow people to improve themselves there? My friend Frank Diana put together this slide, which you can, when you download it, look at more detail. But basically what it means is that we have exponential changes, but they're also combinatorial. That means on top of each other. This is the scary part. If it was just one thing like 3D printing or artificial intelligence, we could follow that. But now we have 28 or something, right? All happening at the same time. Right? The Internet of Things, cognitive systems, nanotechnology, robotics, the blockchain, digital money, they're all happening on top of each other. So not only do we have to think exponential, we have to think combinatorial, right? We have to look lateral, right, to see what else is happening around us. And we also have to think of it as a combined effort where we go from one to the other fairly quickly. The company that really knows how to do this was mentioned earlier as Tesla. I mean, Tesla is the combinatorial company by definition. They're not a car company, they are a mobility company. They are an energy company. They're in the solar business. They want to redo our grid. They're actually in all of those businesses. Of course, that's a lot easier if you have Elon Musk as a CEO. And if you can go like, you just go for it, right, without considering shareholders or ROI or, you know, as a big company, like a big bank, this is a lot harder, obviously, right? Because they have history and legacy. So that is kind of the combinatorial thing that's really important to consider. So I was in the music business for a long time. I used to be a musician and producer, made 20 records. And then when the internet came along, I set out to help the record labels to survive the internet. You know, as you can tell, I wasn't successful. But for the simple reason that I wanted to describe to you, I wrote this book called The Future of Music in 2005. And looking backwards, what Peter Drucker said about innovation is so true. As an example here, in times of change, the greatest danger is to act with yesterday's logic. And talk about the music business, right? I talked to all of those guys on a constant. I stopped doing it years ago, but basically, the music business guy said, if people can download music for free, we don't have a business. So therefore, we go after them not to download for free. They sued 257,000 people for illegal downloading. They went to lobby and all that stuff, didn't do a thing. They lost 71% revenues in 12 years in recorded music. Why is that? Because A, you can't really do that on the internet. It's a copy machine, basically, right? And B, people want to do that. They want to be able to go to the cloud and do these things, right? You have to give them what they want rather than what they should have. So then we have this, right? This is a slide of music. The red bar is CDs, right? I swear in 5 years, nobody will know what a CD is, right? Except for us who collect them. It's all streaming, right? It's all in the cloud. Apple, Google, Deezer, Spotify. So what happened here, this is a good lesson. Forecast for music is this. Forecast for streaming music, basically just hitting a button so it plays, it's huge. Another one saying there was sort of a valley of death, you know, a place where you made less money. But on the other side, it's huge. Well, here's the difference. It will be very big, but it won't be theirs. Right? It'll be these guys who run the music business. Well, Apple already runs the music business, right? It won't be EMI and Warner and Sony or Universal. It'll be those guys. You don't want that to happen to you, whether you're a credit card company or a bank or an energy company. Right? This is the most important part, because you realize at a certain point, there is a new business, but I'm not running it. In advertising, for example, all the money in internet advertising and publishing goes to the startups like BuzzFeed and others, right? Doesn't go to the New York Times. So that's something to figure out. How do you actually do this? Before this happens, right? So you come too late to the party. Too little, too late. Right? So whatever you do, don't do what the music business did. They're finally getting into it and figuring out it's a little bit late now. And basically, in 5 years, very few artists will consider EMI Music the first choice to get their music out, right? Well, they're already thinking it's basically YouTube, right? So anyway, so there's two major things happening here. One is automation. Anything that can be automated will be automated. That's the law of digital Darwinism. Fast food joints, truckers on a highway going a straight road in like a car train, airline pilots. It will take longer because we will feel reluctant to go into an airplane that's a robot, right? But big airline companies are looking at this today and saying, wow, so much money we could save if we didn't have unions with pilots, right? Like Lufthansa, big issue. So automation is everywhere, and the other one is dumb things are becoming intelligent. And I'm not talking about people, I'm talking about processes and devices. Logistics. We could save 60% of costs by making, connecting, interconnecting logistics, shipping, maritime, solutions, containers, products. It's happening across the board everywhere, including, for example, money, financial transactions. So automation and intelligence together, it's a very, very powerful thing happening. Sergey Brin from Google said 3 years ago, 4 years ago, we want Google to be the third half of your brain. That's interesting. Well, they've become sort of the second half of our brain already, right? So basically, our mobile devices are our outsourced brains. A lot of people don't remember the phone number of their partner because they have it saved in the phone. Right? A lot of people can't find their way around town without Google Maps. They certainly would never eat anywhere without looking at TripAdvisor. So they have already achieved this goal. In fact, Google is on the way. Somebody from Google here? Okay, so I can speak openly, that's good. They're also a client of mine, so I have to be careful. But Google is on the way of becoming the global OS, the global operating system. Okay. Google is buying every single artificial intelligence company you can think of, including Boston Dynamics, Boston Robotics, you know, the military robot. Google is on the way of shifting from a search engine to an artificial intelligence enterprise. You will not be searching probably in 3 years. Google will know what you want and show it to you without you doing. In fact, Google is hoping to be your digital assistant for your life, for everything, whether it's money, dating, phone calls, financial investment, airplane, tourism, everything. It's a mind-boggling thought. So now we're moving into a new ecosystem. And I think if you're part of the old ecosystem, which was in many ways an ego system, really, right? It's about large companies running large things, right? Now it's completely interdependent. I live in Switzerland, where the Swiss people thought until last year that they can be independent still, as they have been for a long time. And I have a Swiss passport now, so I'm speaking as a French, as a Swiss citizen as well. But the Swiss government has realized it can't. It cannot be independent in a world where everything is connected. So in January this year, they did away with the tying up of the euro. That was a huge shock for Swiss business because they thought they could be independent and regulated, but it's not possible. It's basically an ecosystem. Devices, cloud, objects, things, people. And the interesting part is this is an ecosystem of intelligence. It actually knows what's happening with the other parts, which is new. This is Zuckerberg's company, you know, our friend Mark Zuckerberg, who brought us one of the biggest OSs in the world, Facebook. He invested a mere $250 million in this company, I think, called Vicarious. And this is the headline of the company. We're building software that thinks and learns like a human. Of course, if you work for IBM, you would laugh about this because, you know, you've been thinking about that for 50 years, right? It's not new. But the claim of having an intelligence that thinks and learns and maybe acts like a human, that's a tall order. And that is on top of this thing that's called hyperconnectivity, right? I'm sure you know what that is, right? High speed, all the time, anywhere, always on, right? Fear of missing out. Called FOMO. Right? I mean, we all now, on average, work 20% more because of social media and mobility. That's been a lot of research on this, right? So we lie in bed checking our Facebook update, or you know, check our emails before we go to bed, before we go to sleep, right? So hyperconnectivity is everywhere now. And imagine when that comes to China and India and Africa, right? 6 billion people, hyperconnected people. What kind of fluidity we have there and liquidity? So basically what we have here is as a headline, and we can save this first, exponential, convergent, combinatorial, interdependent. And the singularity kind of idea is saying when this all comes together, then man and machine have converged. Now there's a scary thought. I mean, automation kind of gets us to that point, and I'll explain what that means, but looking at all of those things, that are coming together, it's essentially like a network, right? These things are hanging together, AI, ubiquitous computing, all that stuff. So this is the result, humanity and technology intertwining. Now think about what that will mean for your kids. I mean, you think that's a tall order now, Well, in 10 years, you won't even know the difference. Because there's one big difference. Technology does not have ethics. Well, we wouldn't want it to have ethics, really. Some technology companies have ethics, some of them, or most of them, I hope. But technology itself is void of values. It's void of principles. Never mind religion or beliefs or those kind of things, right? But just principles. A real self-driving car would need ethics, right? Because when we're driving, we're making ethical decisions all the time. We're going to kill the frog, or we're going to run over the woman with the baby. Or we're going to go a little bit too fast, or maybe drink a little bit and still drive, and we make those decisions all the time. It's actually pretty hard to get a computer to do that. So that intertwining is really what I call man-machine. I use that hashtag on Twitter. You can read my stuff on this. So here's a question I have for you. How much do you believe in technology? Oh, well, this is why you're here, right? Because you do believe in technology. All right, that's what we're discussing here. But how deep does it go? That's a crucial question you have to ask yourself. I believe technology is absolutely fundamentally critical for our future to make our businesses better, but it cannot be the only and final destination. Right? I'll explain why that is. Right? So it's kind of a, a schizophrenic point of view, right? We have to have technology to do that, but if we bang only on it, we become completely a commodity, right? Like the music guys did. So I'll give you an example here. Wired magazine last week, genetic engineering, what they call DNA editing, becoming a real possibility in the next 10 years. Sounds like a great business for a lot of people, but imagine if this is invented. And it will cost, say, $10 trillion to develop this, maybe. But the operation itself will take 4 seconds. If we don't actually share this achievement, we have the primary reason for terrorism. Right? Think about that for a second. Like a pharma company that sells AIDS medication, we already had enough issues with those, right? Considering who should buy it and who should buy it for what price and so on. But this is going to be an order of magnitude. And beyond that, of course, the end of dying. Right? I mean, this is no joke. There are at least 50 companies in Silicon Valley whose goal it is to end aging and eventually, you know, the death of death, right? Basically. Probably too late for us, I think, considering what the stuff we have already done. But so Ray Kurzweil, of course, is a Spartan. He takes about 140 packets of vitamin a day because he wants to get to that point where it's possible. You know? Good luck to him. But so here's the question. Now, computing has become like this, from the mainframe to the desktop to the mobile devices, implants, things that we put on our wristwatch, right? Google Glass and all these things that are happening. So basically from inside the body, from outside the body to inside the body. Brain-computer interfaces, BCIs, already working, but you have to really work out pretty hard on them to actually make them work. But if you have $1 million and you have a BCI, you can walk again as a quadriplegic. It's possible. It takes a huge amount of money and a couple years of training. Exponentially speaking, in 5 years, this is going to be available. Brain-computer interfaces where I can control a whole bunch of other machines and possibly other brains using my interface through the internet, connecting my brain to the internet, basically. So then we end up with this scenario. Right? We have to ask a question, how far do we want to take this, right, as far as technology is concerned? How far should we take this? Because quite clearly, if we do this, you know, we can automate away a lot of really cumbersome stuff. We can. How far should we take this? Well, you get the point, right? This is obviously not real, not yet. But, I mean, this is a question of taking an, you know about cochlear implants where you have a hearing problem, you can have an implant that gets you to hear again. I think about 450,000 people in the US have that. And it's basically a fake ear, right? Going directly into the nerve. So that's possible, right? And now there's people experimenting with fake eyes, right? A bionic eye. So it's not that far removed, really. Good luck to Apple for realizing this. But so what I think about this basically is this, right? We're looking at the potential of technology being what I call 90% heaven and 10% hell. That's to say that all the stuff that's happening is potentially really beneficial, solving things like climate change, global warming issues, right? And 10% would be unintended consequences that are going to happen, right? For example, if we have more drones to deliver things, you know, people will buy guns to shoot them down. Right? That's already happening. Certainly an unintended consequence. But if we're not very careful with this, right, it could also flip. That's kind of like nuclear energy. You know, we have to really make sure that we actually are in control of this. So the question really is ultimately about the ethics of technology. So when you're thinking about rolling out an automation plan, you have to also think about the final destination. Where are you trying to go with this? What are you trying to achieve? What is the value of your business beyond the efficiency? That's why it's wiggling. So we have a company in California started 3 months ago called Human Longevity Inc. This is not science fiction. This is real, right? Funded by companies like Genentech. This guy named Peter Diamandis, who runs the Singularity University, he's basically starting a company where you can combine all the biological data, like genetic and phenotype, and use insights from biological data from computation, machine learning, and so on, and eventually get a couple million genomes together and figure out how you can solve problems related to the genomes and how you can then actually change them. And this is what he's saying about this business, right? This is a quote from Peter Diamandis in an interview on Wired, on PC Mag, actually. He says there's $6 to $7 trillion a year spent on healthcare, half of which goes to aging. Right? So the question is, what would people pay for an extra 10, 20, 30, 40 years of a healthy life? It's a huge opportunity. Now, this kind of speaks volumes about the motivation. Right? I'm not saying it's a bad motivation, I'm just saying that seems like an extreme case. Right? So we have to think about what that means in the long run when we do those kind of things. Where is it going? Because now we're going into an era where impossible is doable. Quite literally doable. Right? The speed. Skype has automatic translation built into the latest version of Skype. If you download it, I think most people will already get the latest software. So you can speak in German, comes out in 34 languages in real time. Right? Nanobots in your bloodstream, cleaning your cholesterol. Being trialed right now. Difficult to try with humans, obviously. Brain-computer interfaces, augmented reality, bionic limbs, self-driving cars, vertical farming, the Internet of Things. So the question is no longer if or how, but who and why. And that's the question we have to ask when we talk about automation and robotics. Yes, we can do this. But why and who and where and what is the destination? Because in many ways, you could say clearly it's inevitable, right? I mean, there's no doubt about that. That's kind of like saying that, you know, you like physical music on a record or a CD, but, you know, that's not going to happen, right? It's digital. It's in the cloud. It's not going to go back to physical just because it's a better business model for us. So that's an important question. So I want to introduce one of my key new words. I'm working on a book on this topic, and this is one of the key words. I call this the humor rhythm. And that is essentially is kind of paired up with algorithm. So because we're always talking about algorithms and what they can do, but I want to introduce a new term, a humor rhythm, which is basically all of these things, you know, the things that make us human. And it's very interesting to see that most of those things cannot be nailed down into zeros and ones. Like randomness, mysteries, imagination, intuition, creativity, you know, right brain stuff, basically. And you can clearly see when you're looking at job profiles today, who companies are looking to hire, it's increasingly moving to the right brain. It's either all the way on the left, you know, scientists and technologists, which of course have a right brain as well, but primarily on those kind of skills, and the right brain moving in that direction, right? So now it's actually becoming a question of all of these really complicated things, right? Ultimately, the value of what we do will be defined very much by this in the future, to figure out how that all hangs together. Apple is a great example. Apple got into the music business again with streaming, and the news business with the new release of the news app. And Apple is saying, well, it's great if we have an algorithm that can determine what's important for Gerd or for whoever, right? That's good, like Pandora for music. But we're also going to hire 200 journalists, 57 DJs, to create human stuff, right? Because of course they have the money too, right? So because humans are expensive. That's one of the realizations that we have to come to. Humans are expensive, technology is cheap. So here we have a situation where we clearly are seeing Apple will make all the difference by the people. They're going to use smart technology, of course, just like Spotify and everybody else, right? But investing in people. So a question I have for you is, our society ready for this, right? Here's a short commercial from a Dutch insurance company. I think they're sort of nailing it why this is happening, and I think you'll enjoy this one.
The all-new self-driving car. It does the driving for you, so you can catch up on the more important things in life. It automatically takes the right turns. Effortlessly avoids unexpected obstacles. And recognizes red lights far in advance. Ensuring you a perfectly safe journey.
Well, you get the point, right? This technology is pretty much ready. Not entirely, but are we socially ready for this? Do we have the context for this? That's a big question. So that is a question we have to answer if we're, before we roll it out, because as we call this in Europe, the precautionary principle would apply, right? We have to make sure that when we're doing this, we don't cause too many negative consequences. Right? This is not as simple as just saying, let's just do it and people will get used to it. So something to think about before we do this. So, we talked about this in the beginning. Now we have basically everything, you know, things, stuff, hardware, wetware, which is us, right, being made intelligent. Smart farming is such an example. Right? Did you know the number of people employed in America in farming has gone from like 42% to less than 1%, right, in 50 years? And in 5 years, it'll be 0.1% because of smart farming. But the number of the stuff, the food being produced, right, has exploded. It's a mind-boggling amount of productivity. Smart farming, the Internet of Things, everything being made intelligent. Lots of people estimating roughly in 10 years we may have as many as 500 billion connected devices. Pipelines, networks, sensors, cars, everything. Very intelligent devices. This is a slide from Ray Kurzweil's book saying 2027 we're going to actually have that sort of capability of the machine brain to match the human brain. So Ray Kurzweil is saying that humanity will be hybrid by 2030, meaning that we're going to augment ourselves, you know, for example, through 3D glasses, virtual reality, implants, brain-computer interfaces. James Barrett, who wrote a book about this you should read, called Our Final Invention, right, about artificial intelligence. Very good read on this. But essentially, it's something to think about. Just a few days ago, it was announced that a bunch of guys have hacked the Jeep, the Chrysler models, and various types of Jeeps, actually, to take remotely control of the vehicle because of the onboard connected system. So they can do stuff like operate your windshield wipers, you know, squirt water the whole time, honk the horn, and disable your brakes. was a contest, basically, a bunch of hackers. So now Jeep has to recall 1.4 million vehicles because their system, their electronic system, is completely unsecure, right? So the other thing that's happening here is that on this exponential curve, we're going to be at threat level severe, right? I mean, you can only imagine today the connectivity of people, that's bad enough, you know, if that information goes out. But if we connect our cars, our healthcare, our banking, our digital money, you know, our education, everything around us, if that is also connected and we're not really sure about how that's being kept, that's not a good idea. So if you're in the security business, you know, this is a huge opportunity because basically we're looking on a scale of 1 to 100. We're at 5 now. In 5 years, we'll be at 50. So it's crucial that we think about what that means and for the future. So what we have here is basically coming together very big and fluid data, predictive analytics, as we will see this afternoon. I call this basically business superintelligence. And the stuff you can do today using those kind of engines, IBM Watson or even Radian 6 and those social media things, right? One person can get the intelligence of a 100-people team from 5 years ago. And finding out in real time what's happening about brands and what people are saying and how they should respond. I mean, we're going to have this kind of business superintelligence, and this is a slide from Libelian that makes sensor networks for environmental control, basically connecting every single piece of our environment to a grid, resulting in huge energy savings. Together with the switch to solar energy, this could solve the energy problem. I mean, we're actually there where we can say, well, clearly this is now possible. So what's happening here, however, this kind of superintelligence requires superhumanity. Because imagine what happens if we use superintelligence to its ultimate effect and we don't have humanity, right? Then we're stuck in a system that we basically can't control or we don't feel good living in. This is a very important point. We'll go back to that in a second. Bottom line is this, in the end, technology does not have ethics, right? It's a machine technology. We have to inject that into it in some form. We'll talk about that when we talk about the stuff in the right after this talk, right? Our society depends on those things. It's kind of interesting to see that actually 95% of transactions that people do are not based on facts. Buying stuff is the greatest example, right? The entire economy is based on illogical, irrational, emotional, and subconscious choices. And we're going to solve that problem with the algorithms. Right? I think we can use the algorithms to make it better and more efficient, right? And organize it better. But there's something that we're going to miss if we just use the algorithm. And then we have this on top of all of these things that's happening behind the scenes. We have this, right? We're going to be augmented in visual terms. It has been tried years ago, you know, and of course, Google Glass, right? To actually use our augmented information that we put on a visor or glasses, and it was kind of clunky, didn't have a social purpose really. But now there's over 100 companies that do this. Microsoft HoloLens, if you ever get to try it, you should try it. Oculus Rift, Samsung HR, HD stuff, right? It's mind-boggling. We're going to see this for doctors, for policemen, for trade shows, for check-in here at the hotel. It's going to be second nature, like SMS, like WhatsApp. Every single policeman in the world wants this kind of gadget. They can see who you are, they can recognize your face, they can pull up your records as you get out of the car. So that is going to be augmentation, virtualization, simulation becomes completely normal. This is kind of stuff for like games now, you know. People like to use in games, but imagine using this for education. Going inside of a virtual world to play a business game. That already exists, but it's clunky. That is going to be a future that most of us will see. Augmenting ourselves to see further. And augmenting in the sense of wearing something, you know, initially, right? Because that's still outside the body. Intelligent assistance. I turn this around and say it's not really AI, it's IA, right? In fact, I think that's a much more appropriate term. Intelligent assistance, intelligent augmentation, intelligence amplification. Using what we do, but make it quicker, faster. The FT says we're going to have roughly $8 billion worth of revenues in that not very much. I think it's going to be a whole lot more than that in just a short time. But Schwab already has a portfolio called the Intelligent Portfolio. It's essentially a robotic advisor. Of course, we'll talk about that this afternoon, this morning with IBM, but many of those things are now becoming possible because you have a real-time data feed of 100 million different sources. Every single bank that's in the lending business is investing in intelligent portfolios. Because the idea being, if you have simple investments, you can probably do it with a robot. And Fry and Osborne, who did a great study you should download from Oxford University, saying that roughly 40 to 50% of jobs will go away. They're saying 58% of financial advisors will be replaced by robots and AI. I've tried some of those systems, and it's pretty mind-boggling what they can do. They're not human in the sense of saying that I don't want to invest, say, in defense or something, so they wouldn't care, right? They just go for the numbers, right? They don't go for sentiments. But they can do simple stuff, and they're going to get exponentially better. And all the stuff that you probably already do on a daily basis, Siri, Cortana, Facebook MoneyPenny, it's a new project by Facebook, intelligent digital assistants. I don't know if you've tried Siri on your iPhone or Google Now on an Android phone. Right? I mean, the stuff you get from this is pretty mind-boggling. You can already speak to Siri, the Apple device, and say, you know, send an email to XYZ. Pull up this information, turn on the radio, play rock music. And Amazon just launches a new box called the Echo that you can buy. You put it into your living room and you speak to Echo like you speak to a person. And it will play music, it will cue up videos, it will reorganize your library, it will do all that stuff on demand, right? Intelligent assistants. They're going to be as cheap or probably even free in big, large-scale operating systems. So you can say we're moving into a world that's anticipatory, prescient, predictive, some people say even precognitive, you know, being able to decide. For example, police departments in several places in the US have already defined a group of people that are likely to commit a crime in the next month, and they go to their house and offer them therapy, right? Not a joke, right? Saying, we have identified you as a high risk, so, right? This is already happening. Imagine if you go to your bank, you go to your clients, you say, you know, I've looked at your portfolio, and our engine says, you know, there is like, 74% likelihood this is not a good thing what we currently are doing. Right? Of course, a person could do that. Right? But having all the information in real time, like every 10 seconds with an update, that's really powerful stuff. You know, a doctor making the rounds in a hospital, having IBM Watson next to him, and looking at 158,000 cases of exactly the same cancer, than he has in front of himself right there with a patient, right? That is vastly more powerful than having to go back to this office and Google for stuff, right? I mean, we're talking about a doctor with a digital assistant would be so much more powerful and freed up to actually talk to the patient because the assistant would do all that work, you know, write the prescription, look up stuff, file things. So if you have kids, don't let your kids become bookkeepers. Financial advisors, truck drivers, fast food cooks, right, those kind of things. We're looking at a rapid, of course, you don't want to do that anyway. Fast food cooks is not a very popular job. But in America, the fast food environment is a last resort for a lot of people, you know, who are out of a regular job. They go to Burger King for 6 months to make money. That's a very important part of the food chain, actually, in the over economic terms. Right? UBS has already invested in artificial intelligence of various sorts. Schwab is already in that, so it's basically just a question of time. So we're going to do our first poll, so please pull out your app. Pull out your mobile weapons, please. So basically you have one choice. Here are the choices. And if you go to the session for today, you have the app? Yeah? You guys have the app actually loaded? I hope so. Otherwise, we can just do hand signs, good old-fashioned way. You can choose one and just tell me how do you feel about the rise of intelligent digital assistants. Just what is your opinion on this? And can we switch it on? I think if you have the app, then you can see the choices there anyway. Let me switch the screen. Okay. All right, interesting. Okay, it's reordering actually by priority, I see. Okay. This is just a way to capture the sentiment in the room and also for discussion later. We'll have one more of those later. But it's very interesting to see here, right? It can't wait. I can't wait is a very high pyramid here. I get this a lot, and it's really interesting. In Europe, it's the other way around. People are saying, yeah, it sounds interesting, but also very scary. I'm not sure what it will do to my lives. Will it possibly deplete and cause dependency? So the second one here, it sounds very promising as long as we don't lose our capital. That's kind of a middle path, right? So we like to take the middle path. That's actually quite good. But the picture is pretty clear here in this room, mostly positive, I would say. We'll go back to that in a second. Let's go back to my slides, please. All right, so basically what's happening here is that these things are reframing our lives, are literally reframing, creating a different context. Automation, robotics, artificial intelligence, and they're reframing everything, not just business. I mean, that's why I'm going to give you here the what I call the seven Asians. They all end with Asian of some sort. When you download the slide, you can dig in deeper. But basically, the seven Asians are digitization and dematerialization, which means, for example, movies are no longer on DVDs. They're in the cloud. Right? Books are no longer books. They're in the Kindle. Right? Automation, virtualization, which is, you know, cloud computing, Salesforce, and those kind of things. Optimization, augmentation, which means changing humans to be more powerful, and robotization. When you're looking at the seven Asians and you're looking at examples of this, then you're basically saying, wow, you know, if all this is happening at the same time, it sounds a bit like a nirvana for companies running businesses because, for example, if you ran a call center, putting those things together, you can say clearly, I'm going to have a lot less people work in the call center. Right? I mean, it has been tried for a long time, but it's actually finally happening. There's a great quote by Hemingway who said, how do people go broke? Gradually, then suddenly. And it's very interesting to see, and that really applies to technology, because a lot of us are basically looking at this like paperless office or media in the sky, in the cloud, and those, you know, didn't happen for a long time. But when they finally happen, it's huge. Gradually, then suddenly, that's exponential. Right? So looking at these things, you know, if you have a call center, you know what's going to happen here. Technology will get so good that 92% or so of your calls can be handled by software. So that brings up a lot of issues, possibilities. For example, this whole idea of cloud computing. Basically, this business model, this is from The Economist from last week, right, saying that every single business is moving into the cloud regardless of the risk because it's competitive so much better. Right? It creates entirely different possibilities. Right? And then with cloud computing, of course, the biggest problem is how do we actually make this work on a large scale that is not as insecure as our email or Facebook? Right? I mean, this is a major challenge that we will have to solve. And some of the consequences of this are as follows. Right? First, dependency. Right? As we're traveling, you know, I was in Zanzibar a year ago, which is the east coast of Africa by Tanzania. And I went with my son, who was 18. And we're sitting on the beach, and of course he wants to play music. You know, kids always want to play music, I'm sure you're aware of that. So we're sitting on the beach, and he pushed on his mobile. He keeps pushing and pushing and pushing, and nothing happens. Right? And I said, what are you doing? He said, well, my mobile is broken. I can't get the music to play. Turns out his music is not on the mobile. It's in the cloud, right? And there was, of course, no internet on the beach in Zanzibar. Right? First time in his life where he was not connected to the music cloud, and he didn't understand the problem. It's like air, like oxygen. It's like saying, I can't breathe, you know, let me hit the button. Right? Imagine if we get connected in such a way. Dependency will be huge because we're going to be depending on all of that connectivity, just like the cloud will be something, right? I mean, the self-driving car, in its ideal case, gets 1 terabyte of information a minute. Right? The car will not drive if it doesn't have data. will just sit there, as opposed to human, right? That's a huge challenge. Imagine you're driving somewhere in Finland and, you know, all of a sudden you're out of the reach of the network and that's it, right? You have to go and collect berries in the forest somewhere, right? Displacement of jobs. Yeah. From the business angle, that's, you know, the less people I have, the better, clearly, right? But societal angle will make that quite difficult, right? If a company that runs call centers can fire 90% of the staff, should they be required to retrain them? Or should they just keep the profit and move on? I mean, these are huge questions that we're going to have to answer. Right? And the last one is this, most important for you. Rabbits. No, kidding. Abundance. Automation is a tool for dramatic cost reduction, and it generates abundance. The more you automate, the more abundant the service becomes. Because clearly, when you automate, it has to get cheaper. Not just for you, but also for the clients. And it creates abundance, which means that it's all available. For example, if you use Spotify, the music service, or YouTube, Spotify has 16 million songs on its service. And you pay $7 a month. So the problem with Spotify is not the music, it's a selection of music. Right? Which music are you going to pick? That is a huge challenge. Think about that for a second. If somebody is going to sign up with you as an outsourced technology provider, if this technology prevails everywhere, you're just one of the providers of an abundant service. It's like in telecoms, where I do lots of work. Everybody gets you a phone call and fairly cheap mobile broadband. When that becomes abundant, what are you going to say about your service? You're going to say, well, it's even cheaper. Right? Then you have to start paying people to use your service. It's already very cheap. So what do you do then? You have to add values. I mean, Spotify is a great example. Netflix, right? The most abundant movie service in the world now, 72 million subscribers. Abundant, you can watch anything, anytime, anywhere. The Kindle, Uber. Right? Uber has just launched a group service called Uber Pool. In San Francisco, you can now go to San Jose for like $6.50. I mean, you can't even take the train, if there was one, right? You can't even take the train for that little. And now it's becoming abundant transportation. I mean, JetSmarter, you know, you guys know JetSmarter? You can take a private plane. That's Uber for planes. For one-tenth of a regular, you know, it's... Of course, you don't want to get started on this because you get used to it, but that... 3D printers, abundant anything, shoes, plastic covers, you know, whatever you want to print. So what we're seeing here really is a situation that Peter Diamandis has pointed out. We're going, because of this demand and supply, all of us in business are going to one destination, that is abundance. It's much harder to be abundant, of course, with, you know, say, diamonds, for example, right? or energy, right? Or oil, because it's physical. But money, for example, banking, tourism, services, outsourcing, software, right, becomes abundant because we're automating. So at that point, you know, when we reach this point, we have to think about, for example, in the energy business, you know, looking at the price of solar going towards zero, the price of oil also declining, basically means abundant energy by 2035. Hard to imagine. What's your business going to be by then? There's a great book by Peter called Abundance, which is very blatantly, you know, techno-optimism, but you should still read it. It's a good read to think about this topic. So let me summarize on abundance, that automation is a tool for abundance. It ends scarcities. And that's a certainty. In many ways, that's good, because when you end certainties, you can, scarcities, you can also invent something else because it also lowers the prices and margins. And that's not always a good thing. I mean, clearly in the music business, you wouldn't be so happy about the margin of a song having declined from the CD to the stream. Right? So this is an important point. To generate new values, you will need to focus on things that cannot be made abundant. This is the key point, right? When you automate, things get cheaper. That's great for you, great for the customer. Right? And then what you do, you invent new things that are only possible because of the automation. And those are the ones you're going to make money on. That's a key point. It's not automation itself that will make you lots of money in the future. That's just a tool to get to this point where you can think of other things that are not automatable. Unlike algorithms, the humor rhythms, for example, cannot be automated. Anything that's human about your company, purpose, design, brand, right, becomes much more powerful, cannot be automated. Some people have said happiness can't be automated. Right? And ultimately, the purpose of business is customer happiness. Right? So there has to be something in place there that makes it possible for you to go beyond abundance. Right? Because in 5 years, maybe 8 or 10, depending on what business you're in, we will reach what I call total efficiency. That basically means that all the stuff is taken out that makes it inefficient. And until then, you can make lots of money with efficiency. But then you have to think about purpose and human values and other key business assets. So this is a very common theme when we talk about automation, right? You want to reach maximum efficiency level. That's good, but let's keep in mind, this is just a path. It's not the destination. It's a good path to take, a path you have to take because it monetizes, right? But it's only the first step. What comes after the efficiency? What comes after the possibilities of saving money? So I made this pyramid, which I think is showing it pretty nicely. It's that automation, digitization, you know, the seven Asians, as I call them, right, being at the bottom of the pyramid, they generate this, and they basically kind of move around a little bit depending on what business you're in. Right? But the ultimate way to monetize what you do is on top, right, is the purpose. So why you're doing stuff, who you're doing it for, how you're doing it, what do you stand for? 82% of millennials, the latest research shows, care about companies, whatever, doing the right thing, right? Being the right thing, having the right purpose. They would rather buy from a company that does that than not. Right? Very important point to think for our future. So talk about jobs a little bit, and then we'll go towards the end. So definitely what's happening here, unlike anything before, robots really will mean a lot of jobs getting lost, my view. I mean, the compound effect of all the stuff that's happening, I was just in New Zealand, just as I was leaving, I was looking at the newspaper and it says, announced today, no more people cleaning Auckland Airport. It will be all robots rooting around and cleaning the airport and laying off half the people who used to clean. This is happening in every aspect of society. In Freiburg in Germany, I go to a restaurant a lot, and they recently switched. There was a sushi restaurant. They fired half the staff and put iPads on the table. You order the iPad, and then people just bring the food. No more discussion about the food. They just, you order it, and that's it, right? Saving wages. To which Martin Luther King already said years ago, right, basically what's happening here is this will probably eventually lead us to a guaranteed basic income guarantee called the BIG, basic income guarantee, which will be extremely difficult in the US. For lots of reasons. In Switzerland, we have this on the ballot already this year. I mean, there's only 7 million people in Switzerland, right? We could afford it, right? But that's a very tough question, right? How will this be done in a large country like India or the US? I don't know. But. So technological unemployment, this time it's real. So that means change in education, change in HR, because basically, after the dramatic automation that is coming, that we're all a part of, obviously, right, everything that cannot be automated will explode in value. So the first wave will be automation. The value itself will be in the automation, clearly, right, because there's lots of things to be cut out with automation. And then afterwards, the second wave will be those things that cannot be automated, like empathy, intuition, imagination. More right-brain things, even though that's a very old-fashioned way of looking at it. But basically the right-brain stuff that we're going to add to that in the future. So I'll give you a short video, and then we'll wrap up. Basically, it's a great video you should watch. You may have seen this on the web. It's been around for a while. It's called Humans Need Not Apply. And I'll give you a short excerpt about humans being the next horses. You'll understand after you watch this.
Imagine a pair of horses in the early 1900s talking about technology. One worries all these new mechanical muscles will make horses unnecessary. The other reminds him that everything so far has made their lives easier. Remember all that farm work? Remember running from coast to coast delivering mail? Remember riding into battle? All terrible. These new city jobs are pretty cushy, and with so many humans in the cities, there will be more jobs for horses than ever. Even if this car thingy takes off, he might say, there will be new jobs for horses we can't imagine. But you, dear viewer, from beyond 2000, know what happened. There are still working horses, but nothing like before. The horse population peaked in 1915. From that point on, it was nothing but down. There isn't a rule of economics that says better technology makes more better jobs for horses. It sounds shockingly dumb to even say that out loud, but swap horses for humans and suddenly people think it sounds about right. As mechanical muscles pushed horses out of the economy, mechanical minds will do the same to humans. Not immediately, not everywhere, but in large enough numbers and soon enough that it's going to be a huge problem if we're not prepared. And
I'll leave it at this. The whole thing is 15 minutes long. You should watch it. It's obviously rather pessimistic on the future of jobs. I don't actually agree on the last part. You know, I think what we're seeing here is that lots of jobs that are really robotic to begin with, they will obviously be gone, right? But there's going to be so many new jobs as well, for example, in technology and science, right? As well as in the interfaces, for example, augmented reality, virtual reality, right? Design, intuition, delivery of business models, entrepreneurship. Right? It's still going to be a pretty hard shift for those that have those robotic jobs, right? To lose them. That's a true challenge. Right? So basically, we cannot allow technology to trump humanity. And this is Descartes who came up with the idea of animals being machines. He called them the automata, which is basically, you know, creating an image of a living organism as a giant machine. Right? That would have no purpose for us. I think we need to look further and also ask this question, what should or what should not be automated? Very important point. Not everything that can be automated should be automated. For example, you take a giant engine and you filter all the traffic and results from your human resources department and sales. You know, if you have a big organization, you can get to a couple of hundred million records, right? And then you push a button and say, who should I fire based on this information? Right? Well, that's already being done, can be done. Is that right? I don't think it is, right? Because there's many things that cannot be automated in the system of value in companies. You know? What does that person do? What is between the lines? What is not actually email transfers or LinkedIn postings or whatever you have, right? That's like saying when I read a TripAdvisor review, I go to this restaurant, it'll be 100% good if TripAdvisor says it's 100% good. We all know that's not true, right? Because it's relative. It's good, but it's not 100%. For example, experiences. You know, we're moving into an experience economy, and it's been said for a long time. It's actually finally becoming true. Experiences are much more powerful than purchases. And so in this world, we're basically saying, well, we are not really able to automate experiences, so therefore they become really valuable. And so your customer's experience with you is the most valuable thing because it cannot be replaced by machines or by a process. It can be aided by machines. It can be supervised by machines. It can be innovated by machines and algorithms. Huh? But it is it's an actual human experience, right? It's a relationship. Basically, this chart shows when you download it, it's the progression of the economic value is moving towards from the service to the experience. And so what we need to do in business is we have to innovate in the service economy, which we're discussing today. And that is definitely going to happen, and it's very important. Right? There's huge potential there. And then we have to innovate on the experience economy. Or better yet, both at the same time. So the algorithm and the humorism. For example, the quantified employee. You know about that idea, right? Basically quantifying people for their performance on work. I think it's interesting, but it's probably as interesting as saying that your Twitter score is 62% or whatever, right? That is interesting, but what does it actually mean? You're going to hire somebody based on how high their cloud score is or their peer index? Or you'd never do that. You'd do that for a typist or a runner, you know? You wouldn't do that for a person that actually has human value. It's just a data point that you use, and it's very important. Anyway, so we have a second poll, and then we'll wrap up. These are the questions, so pull out your weapons. How would you feel about humans becoming artificially intelligent? That's the extension of the first question. How would you feel about if there was actually a way to augment ourselves to become more powerful, physically with implants, with glasses, with augmented reality, with changing your body, with taking certain nootropics, with pills, with physical things, whatever the task may be. All right, can we switch? Okay, I gave you a good way out here. I was too generous with the answers, I suppose, right? Anyway, the biggest bar here is, once again, is the it's inevitable and just the next step. And the second one is that we should embrace it but define clear borders. Personally, I'm on the green bar here, pretty much. I think it's kind of inevitable, but what we need to define what it actually would do and why and how, right, to actually go in this direction. A little bit out of time, so let's go to the next slide, and then we'll go back to this in a second and push them up as well. So clearly, you know, this is a future we're heading into. Machines taking these jobs, and I think this study from The Economist, which is a study on disruption by robots, great study, you should download, it's free, basically says that we're moving into a direction to where jobs will increasingly demand skills in creative problem solving and in right brain situations. So here's my summary, basically. Successful organizations have to master both. Algorithms, automation, technology, robotics, AI. And clearly, you know, right now we're kind of looking here because it looks like it's a saving thing, right? It's an efficiency drive. It works, and that's a good thing. I'm not putting that down. And ultimately, we have to take another step further and say, what if we look at the algorithms at what we stand for, right? What happens after automation or along with automation? And they're actually very closely related. So that's an exercise we have to do, because ultimately, of course, this will also make us stand out as a brand in a whole different way. So quick summary. First, the future is exponential, combinatorial, and interdependent. You try to be independent and linear or behind the wall, extremely difficult. Apple can do it. That's pretty much all the only company I know of that is successful being behind the wall. Or maybe LinkedIn to some degree. So the sooner we can adjust our thinking and think laterally, the better. So when you're thinking today, for example, when I speak in Switzerland and people are saying, well, that's all nice and fine, but you know, we can just wait and see. I always see wait and see means wait and die. Because in an exponential world, you cannot wait and see, because things are too quick to catch up after you recognize them. When looking at artificial intelligence, maybe look at intelligent assistants first. That's a very good interim step. You know, how can you define products and services that are intelligent augmentation of what your customers want to do? I think that's a very powerful choice for the future. Efficiency and cost reduction is a good story, but the final destination is to go beyond the seven nations, right? The inevitable abundance, and create new values that cannot be automated. We don't just need better algorithms, we also need stronger algorithms, right? Principles, values, social contracts. In the end, business is a giant apparatus of a social contract, right? Aided by technology. Alan Kay has a good quote on this that I want to finish with. He said, the best way to predict the future is to create it. And that's what I wish for you. Thanks very much for listening, and I look forward to our discussion. Thanks.